Welcome back to Mr. Joyrider Gaming. You know, the Atari 5200 gets a lot of flack, and I think undue flack. There were some problems with the controller, certainly, and some problems with, as I mentioned in the last video, the RF switch box, but the system itself, the games were fantastic, even though there was only really a handful of games, like 50-some games or something. Now, I'm here to ask the question, is Space Dungeon by Taito the best game for the Atari 5200? And should you be playing it? Should you play it? I would first of all say, yeah, I think that it is the best game for the 5200, and I've played all of them. Now, we got to start out by talking about the arcade version of Space Dungeon. It's 1981 by Taito, and the Atari 5200 version is very similar. This is a twin-stick shooter, all right, which means, of course, you know, you have two joysticks. The one joystick works on the movement of the ship, and the other works on where you aim your gun. Now, the big difference between the Atari version and the Taito, the arcade version, is the fact that the vector graphics, first of all, for the Taito version, and the speed. Everything is a lot smaller and moves a lot faster in the on the arcade cabinet. The most difficult thing today about the 1983 Atari 5200 version of the game is getting it to work, being able to play it, because you need two 5200 controllers. Now, when we were kids, we used to play this. My brother would be the one that would drive, and I would be the one that used to fire the weapon. But you could also, it came with a little attachment that you could stick both controllers in the attachment, and then one person could play both. Now, it's fun both ways, but emulating that is very difficult because you have to find all the parameters, set them correctly to be able to control them with one controller for the most part. So I was able to do it with a PlayStation 4 controller where I used the D-pad as the movement of the ship, and then I use the buttons, the fire buttons, as, you know, the directional firing. Now, let me tell you about a little bit about this game. It's been compared to Robotron 2084 because of the directional joysticks for moving. It is one of the first twin-stick shooters released the same year as Mars, according to Wikipedia by Arctic Electronic. For the arcade version, you've got 36 rooms arranged by a 6x6 grid. Rooms are connected by open doorways of various sizes. Right, and so what you got to do is, you got to go through this game, and you are looking to collect as much treasure as possible. And there's a reason for that. The game is very difficult. You could certainly go right to the end of the level, like in Gauntlet, without collecting anything, and you can progress. But, obviously, the more treasure you get, the more points you get. And you get an extra dude at every 10,000 points. So, the first level, though difficult, and you can easily lose all three lines on the first level, you want to try to collect as much treasure as you can that first level and get as many extra guys as you can. If you do it well, you can come out of the first level with four guys, and then move on to the next level and keep doing the same thing. And the way to do that is you move through the map, you keep on going, and you just collect every treasure you can. Another cool thing is, cool and hard, whenever you die, you drop your treasure in whatever room you're in, which then you have to go back and collect it. It does put an X on the map for where you were the last time you died, so you sort of know that. Level 2, which you're seeing now, the one sort of flashing character that's moving on the map in the on the top portion of the screen in the middle, that's the thief. And the thief goes around and he steals treasure, like a thief does. And you have to find that thief if you want to collect all the treasure. He'll also go to rooms that you were in that you died in, and he will collect that treasure as well. So it's imperative you know where the thief is. As far as the hazards in the actual rooms, you'll see there's different types of aliens, different types of ships you're trying to fight, and some of them easier than the others. This sort of one with the arrows pointing out, those are his shields, and you gotta fight through the shields before you can hit the white part in the center and destroy them. These guys here, the yellow and orange guys, they fire projectiles. The purple guys fire three projectiles when they're killed. And then you've got the little boxes, guys that are like little, you know, they look like fruit savers. Those guys there. And they're just coming at you, no big deal. But what happens is, whenever you have, whenever you try to leave the room that you were just in, it will block a portion of the door, like in Berserk. And that will not help if you're trying to go back to a room or you accidentally leave a room. I think what kills you the most, beyond the yellow and orange guys, are these guys here in the corners. They will shoot you in whatever direction they have to connect with themselves, so it'll if there is another one at the bottom or another one at the top, and it can connect with it, they'll fire a laser across, and it happens very fast. Cannot get away from it. So if they fire that at you, then you are indeed going to die. And if you're in the path of destruction, you know. And it's very easy to go into a room, guns blazing, and still run into a guy. It's also very easy to have your weapon not hit precisely wherever the hitbox is, and they can come right at you. See there, we just shot the thief and all the treasure that spilled out in the room. Unfortunately, when we did that, a couple of bad guys popped out as well. But we're able to then collect the treasure and then move on. Hopefully, then at the end of the level, getting the $10,000. You got to carry 10,000 points. You got to carry $10,000. You got to carry the treasure towards the end of the room to collect the points to then get the extra guys. It's very, very difficult. It took me a few. It was probably about 30 years between playing this game as a kid and playing it as an adult, because I didn't know how to play it, and my Atari 5200 no longer works. So, I was very much looking forward to playing it, and very much not disappointed with how much fun I remember it being. It's frantic gameplay. It is reward-based. It makes you want to keep going. It makes you want to see how far you can go. I got to around depth 7, and that's using the tactic of getting all the items in the first level and then just trying to fly through the rest of the levels. I've tried to do it the other way, where it's all the treasures in every level, and it just gets really hard because everybody starts moving really quickly, and then it's more reminiscent of the MAME arcade game. So, I asked you before, is it something that you should play? Yes, this game is great. If you can get the joysticks to work or the controllers to work, I would pick this one 100% over the arcade, the easier to get to work arcade version. That version is just crazy fast, and this is much, much more of a beginner's version of that game. And is it the best game on the Atari 5200? I think it might be. I would say out of every 5200 game, and I love the 5200, it's my favorite system, this is the one that I like yearned for the most to play, and it did not disappoint. So much fun, even better because it's a two-person a game. You can play it with two people, which is wonderful. And it is just a heck of a lot of fun, a good play. I was playing the other day, and my wife says, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm blowing stuff up." And that's basically the best way to describe this game. I hope that you play it. I hope that you enjoy it. Find it any way you can and play this game. All right, thanks for checking out Mr. Joyrider Gaming. If you want to find me online, jaredmorris.com. That's my website. Otherwise, like, subscribe, share. I very much appreciate it. As always, I say, good luck, God bless, a good day, sir. I said, good day, sir. Good day, sir.